Charity How To for having me today. So we're going to discuss how to use gratitude to build and strengthen relations with donors and your supporters. My name is Ephraim Gopin. Just quickly, a little bit about me. I've been in the nonprofit world for the last 2 decades. I've worn all the hats from CEO on down. I have my own agency and I work with nonprofits to combine their fundraising and marketing so that they can build more relationships, raise more money, service more impact. In the goal is for fundraising and marketing to work together, because when they think. So I've spent 2 decades building relationships with donors, and that includes using gratitude to strengthen the connection with them. And so today's webinar, you're going to learn from my expertise, my experience, and my collective knowledge. Let's start off with a quick poll just to see where everybody is in terms of, just 1 second. Sorry about that. There we go. And let's launch it. How quickly do you thank donors after a donation, not including a thank you email? And if you could, let's see the responses that we get. How quickly? Some of you within 48 hours of the donation, some of you within a week, some of you within a month. And we have a couple here with when someone on our team gets around to it. We'll leave it up for a couple more seconds. 3, 2, 1, and we'll close and we will share the results. That's great that a third of you are sending out thank yous within 48 hours of a donation. That's great. Within a week is also good. Within a month, and when someone has a time, not great, but we're going to discuss that today and how you can be using gratitude to build relationships with your donors. So what are we going to be discussing today? First, we want to understand who your donors. We want to learn how to say a proper thank you and build relationships with them. We're going to talk about increasing retention, donor retention through proper gratitude. We're going to discuss how to thank new email subscribers, which you might not have thought of as a group of people that you need to be thanking, but it's very important to be doing so. How to use video to say thank you is one way to say thank you. We're going to talk about how to use your phone to say thank you. That's method number two. How to make use of those elementary school cursive lessons that you took all those years ago. That'll be method number three we're going to cover. And method number four of how to show gratitude via your website. And then once we've covered all of that, I'm going to ask everybody to take the gratitude test. So stick around and we'll get to it. So the first thing we want to discuss is how to understand your donors. And that starts with a fundamental question. What is fundraising all about? Well, it's not about the money and it's not about your bottom line. It's about two words: building relationships. And that's what we're going to be focusing on throughout this presentation. As we talk about gratitude, keep in mind building relationships. Let's also understand, why do donors give? And there are a number of reasons. The first one is they want to be problem solvers. Now, there may be homeless people in their community, in your community, and the individual donor, they don't know how to solve homelessness, but they understand that your nonprofit has an expertise in that area. And so to solve that problem, they're going to donate to your nonprofit. People also want to do good, right? It's part of who we are as humans. We want to do good, not just for ourselves, but for other people. And that's why donors give. Another reason why they give is it makes them feel good. Now, that might sound a little self-serving, but the fact is donors do get that good feeling. And there's nothing wrong with that. But that also means that the gratitude that we show them has to continue that and give them even more of that good feeling of how great they are for being donors. Donors want to make the world a better place. Now, they might not be able to do it globally, but in their little corner of the world, if they can make the world a better place, even for one or two people, they've already done something really good. Another reason that donors want to donate is they want to connect to a larger group, or what I call a community of do-gooders. They want to be part of something bigger, of people who are working together to solve a problem in their community. So they don't just want to do it on their own, but they want to be part of this community of other people doing good. And finally, donors give because they have some kind of shared value. with your organization. Those shared values are important to them. They see that in your cause and in the impact you're having, and that's why they want to give. So now that we understand our donors, let's talk about how to say a proper thank you and start building relationships with them. So the first most important thing about having a gratitude attitude, and this comes from Beth Ann Locke, who's the chief spark at thefundraisercoach.com. And she says, it's not the size of the gift that matters, the generousness, it's the act of giving, generosity. What does that mean? If your thank you letters right now today start out with saying, dear Beth, thank you very much for your donation of $100. You're doing it wrong and you want to switch that up. It's the saying thank you has nothing to do with the size of the gift, because even $5 for some people is a stretch gift. So you don't want to make it about the amount that they gave. You want to make it about the act of giving. That's the first thing when it comes to saying a proper thank you and building relationships. Make the person feel good that they gave, not tying it to the amount that they gave. Now let's talk about what are the elements of a good thank you. So the first thing is personalization is critical. They gave a donation, you know their name. Have that letter start out, dear Marcella, you're awesome, Marcella. Hi, Marcella. Thank you, Marcella. Whatever it is, address the donor by name and make sure it's signed by somebody, the CEO, the fundraiser, whoever it is. So now it's a one-to-one communication, building that relationship. Number two, your thank you should be timely. And that's why I had the poll question. For example, McConkie Johnston International says that thanking quickly makes donors 4 times more likely to give again. Again, thank quick, they're 4 times more likely to give again. That's why it's so important. So timely, within 48 hours, if you can, a week is fine. When it goes beyond that, there's kind of this lag, and then the donor begins to wonder, did they get my gift, what's happening with the gift? So you want to be as timely as possible. And I understand some of you work in small shops. That's not always possible. I get it, and that's fine, but as quickly as you can. Your thank you should be more about you, the donor, less us, the organization. Look what you, the donor, have accomplished. Look what you did. Less about us, the organization. Look what we did. And you want to make sure that your thank yous stand out and that they're memorable. And we'll get to that in a second. More elements of a good thank you. Have a little bit of fun. And there's nothing wrong with that. I understand we're all dealing with very serious issues, hunger, homelessness, poverty, educational issues, but you can still have a little bit of fun to make that thank you memorable. For example, somebody donates to your organization, make a quick video of the staff at your organization getting together saying, thank you, John, for donating, and have everybody blow those party horns and throw confetti in the air as a way of saying thank you to them. Send them that video in an email and let them click on it and go watch the video. I guarantee that's going to help build relationships. Again, I guarantee that's a thank you that they're going to remember. Part of your thank yous obviously has to be storytelling. Tell them if your campaign had a certain, let's say the campaign where you asked for money had, you know, please help us solve this. Well, use a story and tell them how they've had an impact. And I say use the story of one. Tell them about one person that their donation has impacted in their community. You want to demonstrate impact, obviously, within, you know, in your thank yous. You want to tell them, how is the donation used? How did they solve a problem? Let that donor know they accomplished something. Again, make them feel good. That's important. And this comes from Beth Ann Locke as well, remove the space between the donor and the recipient, meaning that's why I said tell the story of one. Make that donor understand they've helped this person. It's one-to-one. And this way the donor feels connected to your service recipients. And by doing that, you build the relationship with that donor. So now let's talk about how to increase donor retention through proper gratitude. This is going to be the most important slide in this presentation and something that I hope you'll walk away with. It's from Dr. Adrian Sargent, who's done a lot of research into this area. And here's his quote. The thank you is the single most important piece of communication your donors get. They have a higher recall of it than the appeal that generated the gift. And I want to explain that for just a second. Right now, all of you are working on your year-end appeals. You're working really hard on them. And you're crafting every single word, making sure the messaging is just right, editing, and 17 middle managers are commenting on it. And then you send it out. When a donor gives, do you know what they're going to remember? They're not necessarily going to remember the campaign they gave to. They're going to remember the thank you that they got from your organization. Because if the thank you isn't memorable, they're going to feel that maybe you don't appreciate their donation, and that's going to hurt your retention and hurt the relationship you're trying to build with your donors. Why you should say thank you? Well, I'll get right down to that retention. Two really yucky numbers in our sector. The first one is 45%. That's the average donor retention rate. So if last year you had 100 donors, this year you're only going to retain 45. And now you're chasing your tail, as it were, to find 55 new donors to cover up that budget hole from the 55 you lost. The second number is 18 to 20%. That's the first time retention rate of the retention rate of first time donors. If in 2020 you got 100 new donors, first time donors, only 20 of them are going to be sticking around in 2021, and that's abysmal. We should be building relationships with them so that they'll stick around for longer. And so the goal becomes using gratitude as a way to boost our retention rates and thereby higher lifetime value of each donor. And that means that when you're sending out a thank you, you need to make sure that it's not an end, that it is only the beginning. You're building a relationship. They gave to the campaign, say thank you, and then keep in touch with them afterwards. It's not an end and then, all right, we'll be back in touch in 11 months at next year's end of year appeal. No, it's the beginning of a long road of building and strengthening the connection you have with your donors. So one set of people of you may not have considered saying a proper thank you to are your new email subscribers. And I know that a lot of us have inboxes that are overflowing. It is not a given that new email subscribers, that people are going to subscribe to your email, to your e-newsletter. They don't have time. They have too many emails in their inbox, and they might not be able to pay attention. So when they do sign up, you should be showing them all the love and gratitude in the world. And there are two places that you should be doing that. The first one is on site right away. As soon as they click that submit button, you should either have a pop-up message or take them to a landing page which says a proper thank you to them. And when you do that, use a great image. This image that you can see on the screen is from the San Francisco Ballet. It's backstage. It's a beautiful image, and it's their way of saying thank you to new subscribers. If you want, we'll take, excuse me, I have two more examples for you to look at. The one on the left is from Teach for America. Great image. Thanks for signing up. They're showing the love, showing the gratitude. On the right here is from the Environmental Defense Fund. And you can see in the top right is a polar bear. I love that image. It just blends in so nicely with this pop-up. And the big blue thanks. They show their gratitude. So that's the first place that you should be showing thank you. But then there's another place. And that's sending your new email subscribers a welcome email. And the goal of that is, yep, two words, build relationship. That's what you want to do, because eventually your goal is to convert subscribers into donors. Email is a great way to do that, but you've got to build up that relationship. So why should you send a welcome email? For two reasons. One, it's going to be opened, and number two, people are going to click through. And this comes from Inbox Army. Welcome emails generate 4 times the open rate and 5 times the click-through rate of a regular email marketing campaign. Send that welcome email, build the relationship right away as soon as they subscribe, because odds are they're going to open it and odds are they're going to click on something in that welcome email. And obviously, if you want to build a relationship, inbox visibility is important. If you don't send them a welcome email, they don't know, did I subscribe? Did I not subscribe? I'm not sure. Send them that email, start building the relationship. In terms of the welcome email, very quickly, what should you be sending? What are the components of that welcome email? Number one, it should be immediate, right away. As soon as I click submit on your website, now there's a welcome email in my inbox. Number two, it should be mobile friendly. And the reason for that is the average person looks at an email on their phone for about 5 to 10 seconds. That's it. If the email isn't optimized for mobile, 80% of people will delete and 30% are going to unsubscribe. So if you just worked hard to get somebody to subscribe and now your email isn't mobile friendly, a third of those people are going to unsubscribe. That's obviously not what you want. In terms of the look of the email, you can see here, I've taken an example from No Panic in the UK. There's a great image here at the top. Big thank you, showing the gratitude right away. And then they start telling a little bit about the organization to start building that relationship with the new subscriber. No Panic is here to help, support, and advise sufferers of panic attacks, phobias, obsessive compulsive disorders, and other related anxiety disorders. So you already get an idea of what the organization does. The tone should be warm and friendly, welcome them to this community of subscribers who are doing good in the community and are impacting people in their community. And you want to make sure that you set the expectations. This is from the Franklin D. Roosevelt Four Freedoms Park. You can see here what I've underlined. Expect monthly newsletters. They're building the relationship by telling the new subscriber, here's when I'm going to be in your inbox every month. Additionally, you want to provide them a benefit for subscribing. For example, let's say you run a pet shelter. Let them download an ebook on how to take care of their new adopted pet, but give them something extra, some value added. Always have your social media icons in your emails. Here, this is from the Michael J. Fox Foundation for Parkinson's. This is in the footer of all their emails. It's another way to connect with subscribers and build a relationship with them. They may not see all your emails. They may see you on Twitter or Facebook or Instagram. And of course, if you've asked for their first name, personalize that welcome email. Hi, Beth, it's great to see you. Thanks for joining, Beth. Say their name. If you ask for it, say the name. The one thing you should not do in your welcome email, this hurts the relationship, don't ask for a donation. This comes from Save the Children. I love this e-signature here from their CEO. It means it's personalized one-to-one communication, but at the end, if you'd like to make a gift now, don't do that. And the issue is with that, it's like a first date. You're not asking for their hand in marriage just yet. Build the relationship before you can ask them for even a small donation. So we're going to take a quick break here for just a second. And I have a question for you, but I'd like you to type your answers into the questions box. And my question is, does your organization say thank you to donors only via, let's just say, a mailed letter or email? Or are you using a different method as well? I'd love to hear, yes, we're using a different method and what that method is, or no, we're only doing letters and emails. Just email I see from David. Thank you, David. Let's see what other answers we've got. You can put it into the questions. Just letters from Jennifer, okay. Francesca, just letters. Letter and email from Sarah. Just emails from Natalie. Handwritten notes, Vicky, excellent. We're gonna talk about that in a second. Email and personal note, I like that, Judy. That's good. Phone calls. Oh, Wendy, we're definitely going to be talking about that in a sec. Mail and email, Michaela, that's fine. Emails, letters, phone calls, good. Terry, okay. So I see there's a variety. Email, handwritten letters, this is great. Video, we're going to just calls from board members, big time important. Letters and cards is good. Phone calls, social media is good. All right, I love this. So I see we've got lots of different methods to say thank you. I'm going to share four with you, and I want to tell you how each of them is going to help you build relationships with your donors. So the first one we're going to talk about is how to use video to say thank you. The first thing, as far as video is concerned, we all have a phone. Take it out, hit record, send. You don't need to make a Steven Spielberg type of production. There's no need for that. Personalize that video. You know the name of the donor, start the video with, hi, John, hey, John, thank you, John, you're awesome, John, you rock, John. Use that video also to tell the story of one. Again, use storytelling. In 30 seconds, you can say how the donor has impacted person X in their community. Let them know. Now, on the right-hand side here of the screen, this actually was a Spielberg production, but it was a pretty famous one. It's from a decade ago for some of you. Some of you may remember it. Bowling Green University did a capital campaign to build a new arena. And after it was done, they had university students create a rap to say thank you to the donors. It was called the Stroh Center Rap. It's great, and it was a great way to say thank you. But again, video works. In terms of ideas for what that video could be, it could be a message from the CEO or the staff. Remember what I said earlier about the confetti idea, get the staff together. You can also have a service recipient say thank you. Again, you don't want any space between the donor and the service recipient. Maybe that's a great way to say thank you, and that donor can then see who they're impacting. And if you want a little bit of a fun idea, you can GIF it. And there's an organization that I saw where first-time donors, they send an email to them, and in that email is a GIF of the CEO doing their happy dance. Now, it's about 5-6 seconds long. It looks a little bit funny and uncoordinated on terms of the CEO's dancing, but it's memorable and it'll make donors smile. And when they get a memorable thank you that builds relationships, they're going to stay on for longer. Now, on the right side here, I have my friend Rob. He is an alumnus of Illinois State University. And a couple of months ago, the university had a giving day for alumnus to help with scholarships and other fundraising needs. And he gave. And after he gave, he got this in his email. And it says, thanks for your gift today. And it looks like an envelope here, you know, like they're saying thank you. And a Birds Give Back thanks just for you, Robert. And when you click on the button here, watch your video, you get the following. It starts out with a current student saying, hey, Rob, thank you so much for your donation to, you know, to helping students at Illinois State University. So right away, no space between the donor and the service recipient. And they're looking, the donor can see who they're impacting. Then there was a 2-minute video. Yes, it was a Spielberg type production. It was great, by the way. And it was sent, it's the same video that's sent to all donors. And then at the end is another student saying thank you with balloons and the Illinois State University logo behind them. So it's a great way to say thank you via video. It's personalized to Rob. And when I asked him about it, he said, this is great. I'm going to continue to donate. They built that relationship very well. How to use the phone. Yes, your phone to say thank you. I saw that in my question. Some of you were using phone calls and that's great. Let's talk about phone calls for a second. So the first thing I want to talk about is, I call it dial a smile. Let's talk about the 90-day rule. Boomerang. Boomerang says that calling a first-time donor once or more within 90 days of their donation increases retention rate up to 58% and nearly doubles the amount of the second gift. One phone call in 90 days to a first-time donor, you're going to build that retention, higher lifetime value, strengthen the relationship. Phone calls are personalized because you're calling one-to-one. It's one-to-one communications that you're talking, and you're talking to the donor themselves. While you're on the phone, I'll give you a little tip here. Ask for their origin story. Ask the donor after saying thank you, why do you give to us? How did you find out about us? What impact do you want to have in the community? What do you think is special about our organization that you wanted to become a donor? You know what's great about those origin stories? You're going to hear things about your organization and things you didn't even know about your donors. You can take those stories and then use them as testimonials on social media, email, website, of course, with permission of the donor, but you can highlight your donors that way because now you'll have their story. And that's a great way to shine a spotlight on your donors. Now, in terms of board members, I saw that one or two of you had mentioned that you have board members call. Well, Penelope Burke did a study and she says that a thank you call from a board member within 24 hours of a donation, so I know that's a quick turnaround time, but within 24 hours increases the likelihood of the second gift being 39% larger, okay? Higher lifetime value. And the second one I want to share with you is from Roger Craver. Calls to thank donors generated a 56% increase in first year retention and a 72% increase in revenues. All the data that I'm sharing with you says phone calls help. Phone calls will help strengthen relationships and build relationships, donor retention higher, lifetime value higher. And just as an example, and I know that Giving Tuesday is coming up, but I'm a big fan of what's called Gratitude Tuesday. It's big. A lot of organizations in the UK do it, and some in the US do it as well. Spending Giving Tuesday, not making an ask, but calling donors and saying thank you to them. So this is from Adam Clevenger, who tweeted this out. He's a fundraising consultant. He works with a nonprofit called Second Helpings. And on Giving Tuesday, what did they do? You can see on the right side here, the people in the background are all on the phone making phone calls to donors to say thank you. And again, it was their Gratitude Tuesday. But then they did one other thing very smartly. They kept the data. So here on the whiteboard in their boardroom, how many donors thanked today? 286. They kept track. How many volunteers were recruited? 2. They were just calling to say thank you. They still got two new volunteers. And then here, gifts today, $18,500. They were literally calling to say thank you. They weren't fundraising. And donors were so happy that right there on the spot over the phone, they gave money. So phone calls definitely are a great way to thank donors and to build relationships with them. How about how to make use of those elementary school cursive writing lessons that we, you know, took all those years ago? Some of us may have forgotten them. The first thing is you want to have your pen meet paper. Send them a postcard. It's something that can be in their hand. It's tangible. They can hold on to it, and that makes it memorable. Number 2, a nice written postcard is meaningful. It's warm. It's fuzzy. It gives them that good feeling. Again, donors want to feel good about the impact that they're having and their donation. It's personalized, right? Dear John, thanks, John, and it's signed by somebody. Build that relationship. It's one-to-one communication from whoever their contact is at the organization, and it's not the norm. We spend all day like this on our phones or typing on our laptops and our computers. A handwritten note will stand out. It'll be memorable. And when it's memorable, higher retention, higher lifetime value, much, much better and longer lasting relationships with your donors. So start writing those postcards. And the last method I want to share with you is how to show gratitude on your website to donors. So people are going to be coming to your website and giving online. Well, how do you show them thank you online? It shouldn't just be after they click donate and they fill out the form and they submit their credit card information. It shouldn't just say thank you for your donation. No, that's stale. That's not what you want. That's not going to build relationships, and it's certainly not memorable. You want to make sure you're saying a heartfelt thank you. Tell them they're amazing. Use that pop-up or landing page afterwards to storytell. Tell them how their gift has had an impact. Use a photo for sure, because that'll be something that they can latch onto and that'll catch their eye and catch their attention, and they'll want to learn more. And yes, in your thank you online, you can include social media icons or maybe even ask them if they want to sign up for your newsletter, your e-newsletter. I'm going to share with you three quick examples that I have courtesy from Jonathan Grapsas, who is the head of Flat Earth Direct, which is a consulting nonprofit consulting company in Australia. He did a study with another company in New Zealand, and I want to share with you three examples that he's allowed me to share. So this is from Guide Dogs Queensland. If somebody gives a donation to their organization, this is the pop-up they get. Now, it's for general gifts. So what they've done to show impact is they're sharing three different stories, and people can learn more about the organization and the impact their donations are having. These pictures stand out, and you know, you want to click on one of them. The second one comes from Food Bank NSW and ACT. You can't see it on the screen because I had to sort of shrink it, but on the bigger screen, they've made sure that it's easy to read. Keep in mind your older donors who may have eyesight issues. It's branded well in their purple for Food Bank, and it includes gratitude, it shows thanks, and it reinforces the need. And I want to point out four things here. Number one, look at the verbiage. Thank you for your generosity. Again, it's about the act of giving, not the amount that they gave. Number two, this image right here tells you everything you need to know about who you're helping. Boom, done. Number three, it's personalized. Ash is the name of the person who gave the donation. This pop-up that you get right after donating is personalized. And then number four, it gives you, again, a little, it says great thank you in here, tells you what you're doing, and it tells you that, you know, here's the need in the community and thanking them for having impact. The third one, this comes from the RSPCA, and this is a little bit different. You can see on the top here on the right, thank you, Ash. Again, it's personalized. There's a video here. And what they've done is they've created a simple homemade video, less than 60 seconds. There's light music going on in the background. It's genuine and warm. It's the same, by the way, for everybody. That's not personalized, but it stands out because it's a little bit different. And so if a donor gives and then they see a pop-up and they go, oh, there's a video, I want to watch that video. And now they're going to get a really warm thank you for helping RSPCA Victoria. It's definitely something you want to try out. People love watching videos, and the odds are they're going to watch it. And I remind you, you want it to be memorable, that's going to stick out and be memorable. So before we end, one thing, I'd like you all to take the gratitude test and see if your organization passes. Here's what I'm going to ask you to do. I'd like you to go to your online donation page after we're done, and I want you to give a small donation to your organization. You can do it in your name or use a fake name, whatever you want, but give $5 to your organization. Click submit, donate, you know, fill out the credit card form, submit all the information, see what happens. What pops up on the screen? Is it a really nice pop-up, or do you go to a new landing page which has a great image, tells you about the impact, a little storytelling, or is it just thank you for your donation? That's the first thing you need to check. The second thing you need to check is if you've given online, an email should come to your inbox right away thanking you. A, did that email show up? How quickly does it show up? And B, what are the contents of that email? Does it start out with, dear Marcella, thank you for your $100 gift, because that's not what you want. You want to be talking again about their generosity and the act of giving. That email should include story and impact telling. Make the donor feel good about their giving and that they're solving a problem in their community. And then you want to test further gratitude. Is there a letter coming in the email? Now, I know some of you may be fundraisers and this is your job, but test it anyway. See how quickly things get to the donor. Check the communications you're having with donors, because here's the deal. After you do this test, this is how your donors remember you or don't remember you. And I go back to that slide from Dr. Adrian Sargent. If your thank yous aren't memorable, it's going to hurt your retention. It's going to hurt the relationships you're building with your donors. Make sure that your thank yous are timely, that they're memorable, and that you're using them to build the relationship. Thank you, everyone, for being here today. Thank you, Charity How-To, for having me. I will be sticking around now for a couple of minutes to answer some questions. You know, Marcella will tell me the questions, and I'm more than happy to answer them. If you want, you can invite me. I invite you to email me questions if I don't get to it here, or if you want to ask me, you know, via email. You can reach me at Ephraim, Ephraim, at 1832comms.com. Happy to answer questions about gratitude, fundraising, and marketing. Let's talk. And finally, really important, I would really appreciate if you could fill out the survey that's going to be coming to you very soon. I want to hear your feedback about this webinar and what you were able to get out of it. So I'd appreciate if you could take 1 minute, fill out the survey so that I can get your feedback. Again, thank you so much for attending. I appreciate it. And Marcella, I'm more than happy to take questions from attendees.
Thank you so much, Frame. Okay, so let's see. Judy asks, how much does it matter who signs the thank you note? For example, can volunteers who are integral to our organization write and sign?
Okay, thanks for the question, Judy. I would say like this, if that volunteer is going to be having a relationship with the specific donor, then yes, by all means. If it's just somebody that the donor will never have any other interaction with outside of they sign the letter, I might not do that, because again, that doesn't necessarily build the relationship. If there's no other choice, that's fine, because it's being signed by somebody and you're having that one-to-one communication, it's personalized, that's great. But if it's possible to have somebody who's going to have a longer lasting connection with the donor sign it, that would be better, if possible.
Okay, Judy asks again, regarding calls, if you leave a message, does that work, or do you have to call it till you connect?
At least 3 times. Don't leave messages. I've asked people, I'm a certain age, so maybe it's just me, I don't know, but I've asked people of all ages, do you check your messages? I know so many people, and this is anecdotal, it's not data, but so many people don't check their messages. So I would say if you call and you don't get, you know, somebody doesn't pick up, put it on your calendar to call tomorrow at a different time. And try again, and then try again. Try 3 times and see what happens. And then, if not, send them an email and say, I tried to reach out to you by phone. You know, we weren't able to connect, but I wanted to send this special email, which is besides the regular thank you email, to, you know, show you our thanks and gratitude for your donation. But don't give up after 1 call.
Okay, and we have just 1 last question, but if somebody wants to type in any questions, feel free to do so at the questions box. We may stick around for a couple more minutes, so feel free to type in them. Vicky is asking, how do we address the many young millennial alphas who are no longer taught cursive?
Put it in print. It's all good. I just use the word cursive because I'm a certain age. I learned cursive back in 1977, 1978 in grade 1. And there I just told you all what my age is. But it's okay if it's printed. It doesn't matter. Handwritten is the most important thing. But handwrite it, as long as the donor has something in their hands that's handwritten, it stands out, it's different. And by the way, in your thank you letters, the ones you mail out, I would also add a PS and have that be handwritten by whoever signed the letter. So let's just say it's your CEO. PS, thank you so much, John. We really appreciate it. Just something small, but again, handwritten. Because on a typed out letter, that handwritten PS is gonna stand out. If you wanna do something else, I know we're looking at a post-it note on the screen. Add a post-it note and have them sign the post-it, you know, put a message on the post-it note. That's gonna stand out on your thank you, letter. So yes, handwrite it however you feel comfortable doing so, but use something handwritten, it stands out, it's memorable, and it makes the donor feel good.
Okay, Jeff asks, how do you suggest making connections with donors when you are a new hire? For example, we had a virtual walk emailed phone calls and Zoom up, and then yet still had rough time making connections?
Making connections is not easy, Jeff, and I appreciate the question. It takes time, perseverance, patience. And that's all I can, you know, that's all I can tell you is that there are donors out there who don't necessarily want a connection. They don't want to hear from you. Okay. For example, if you talked about doing a walk for your organization, it could be that the people who are doing the walk raised money from their friends and their family. But those people don't necessarily want to hear from your organization. They were only donors because their friend or family member was walking. So if you've reached out to people in a number of ways or a number of times and they're not reciprocating, pull back a little. It means maybe they just don't want, or now's not the right time. So sometimes you just have to, you know, you have to pick and choose. And that's not, you know, I understand also some people work in small shops. You can't get to everybody. Do your best. And where you can't build that connection, don't necessarily write that person off. Continue to send them emails or engage them on social media, or, you know, send them your printed publications or your annual appeals, or, you know, if you're doing quarterly appeals, continue to send it to them. But maybe put your time and efforts into those people who do want to build the relationship and that you can reach and you can build a connection with.
Great. Okay. Erin asks, is it too much to do a typed out thank you letter and then follow up with a handwritten note later? Or should you typically do one or the other?
First of all, in terms of, thanks for the question, Erin, I would say like this, the typed out thank you letter has to go out. I mean, something has to go out with the IRS tax information on it. So usually that's the typed out letter. I would send the handwritten note a week or two afterwards, wait a little bit, surprise them. They get the letter to their house, and then beyond that, wait a couple of weeks and then send that handwritten note. Maybe it's just a follow-up to that thank you letter. That's how I would space it out. I wouldn't send them together. It's another touch point with that donor and allows you to build a connection. And it's memorable also because, you know, a thank you letter, as I said, it's the start. It's not the end. Some donors may feel, I got a thank you letter. Okay, we're done. Oh, what's this? Now I got something extra. I know plenty of people who put those handwritten notes up on their fridge, you know, with a magnet. It stands out. It reminds them, you know. So I would wait a little bit and then send out that handwritten note.
Okay. Jennifer has like more a comment than a question, so I'm gonna read it. This is true. I gave to an organization because a friend's parents passed away, and that was the designated organization they wanted donations sent to. For a year now, I get two letters every month from them. I have other organizations I regularly give to, and I actually get frustrated about the wasted paper.
So, Jennifer, I completely get it. I would tell you, call that organization and explain to them nicely, you know, the original reason why you gave is for X reason, as you mentioned, and ask them to please remove you from their list. And a good organization will honor your wishes. And I say good because sometimes they'll be like, you know, well, the more letters we send out, the more we're going to get in. No, you're just creating a person who becomes resentful almost of your cause by doing what they're doing. So I would actually get in touch with them and just ask them kindly to remove you from their mailing list, and they'll do so, and, you know, less wasted paper, and you can continue giving to the organizations that matter most to you.
Okay. January, and I hope I'm pronouncing this correctly, is asking, what is the smallest amount that a donor should get a thank you letter for tax purposes?
I don't know the specific answer for that. I apologize. I don't know that one. I would say, though, send a letter anyway. And I'm going to share with you something that I've learned over the last two decades. Treat a $5 donor as you would a $50,000 donor. Now, I know to some of you that's ridiculous, right? The bigger money, you know, we have to cater to them. They're giving us big bucks. I say cater to those $5 donors also. And you know why? Because if you build a relationship with them, next year they give 10. The year after, they're going to give more. And more and more and more and more, and it builds year over year. And you're gonna have higher lifetime value from them than some of your donors who are just one-time donors of $100 or $150. So I say, no matter what size the donation is, send that gratitude letter. Make them feel good. Even if all they gave you was a dollar, make them feel like they've done something good in the community. Make them feel good. Make them feel part of that community of do-gooders. All the reasons we said why they want to give, make them feel the love. Because when you do, I guarantee you, they will remember that the next time you reach out to them. And even if they can only give $5, they're going to continue to give that $5.
Wonderful. We're done. No other questions have come in. So we're ready to wrap it up. Thanks, everyone, for joining us today. Please, as Frame just mentioned earlier, please take a second to complete that survey. Once we close the webinar, it'll pop up because your comments will help us improve our content. And just so you know, that is an anonymous survey. So thanks in advance for doing that. And Frame, is there anything else that you want to say?
I'm filled with gratitude again. Thank you to the attendees who took time today to be here. And I hope this was helpful for you and your organization. Of course, thank you to you, Marcella, and thanks to Charity How To for hosting me.
Wonderful. Thanks, everyone. We hope to see you soon again on another Charity How To webinar. Have a great day. Bye-bye.
Bye.